As allegiances grew questionable and friends ran thin, the ruling family of the crown turned to unconventional individuals to fill their positions of authority. New names were given to the seats of the small council, and men and women were granted privileges based less on experience and authority, and more on personal fancy and loyalty. When the title of Master of Ships was replaced with Grand Admiral, an unsuspecting man was tasked with replenishing the fleet of the Iron Throne. That man was Aurane Waters. Hello everyone, and welcome back to Exploring Fiction. The Bastard of Driftmark was no stranger to the oceans, as he was an illegitimate member of House Velaryon. But like many others appointed by Queen Regent Cersei Lannister, he seemed an odd choice as Grand Admiral. Still, he served the crown, rewarding the Queen Regent with his loyalty and commitment while she ascended to the height of her power. But when the power in the capital shifted and it was unclear who could be trusted and who would rise from the ashes, Aurane Waters abandoned his post, displaying that unlike with blood, loyalty could not be bought with coin. So, who exactly is Aurane Waters, and why is he such an interesting character? Let's explore. Aurane Waters was born to an unnamed member of House Velaryon and an unknown woman, who was not the man's wife, in the year 277 or 278 AC. He was the half-brother of Lord Monfort Velaryon, the patriarch of the house, dubbed Lord of the Tides and Master of Driftmark. Aurane, however, was the Bastard of Driftmark, a fact he did not soon forget. He was raised in Driftmark, but bore no personal coat of arms, despite his unique heritage. As he grew from boy to man, Aurane Waters became quite handsome, with flashing eyes of gray-green and fair hair of a shimmering silver and gold hue. His cleft chin was covered by a slight beard on occasion, and to some, he resembled a slimmer version of the late Prince Rhaegar Targaryen. Although not officially named, Aurane Waters is present in the narrative in A Clash of Kings. He fights on behalf of House Velaryon for King Stannis Baratheon. Aurane partakes in the Battle of the Blackwater, which proves a crippling blow to Stannis and his forces, and upon his capture, the Bastard of Driftmark bends the knee to King Joffrey Baratheon. The next appearance of Aurane Waters in A Song of Ice and Fire is in the fourth entry, A Feast for Crows. Having been pardoned for his deeds during the aforementioned battle, Aurane remains in King's Landing, and even earns recognition from Queen Regent Cersei Lannister. As King Tommen remains too young to make any notable decisions, Cersei rules in his stead, and she appoints Aurane as Grand Admiral, formerly Master of Ships, to Tommen's small council. Due to his experience in such areas, Aurane is granted the funds to rebuild the royal fleet, which was destroyed in the tumult against Stannis, and he allocates the coin toward crafting dramens worthy of legend. The Bastard of Driftmark plots to captain the ships with younger, more able-bodied men, rather than veterans of the Blackwater, earning him particular ire from Grand Meister Pycelle. While Aurane busies himself with replenishing the fleet, Cersei sends Kingsguard member and House Tyrell stalwart Sir Loras Tyrell off to Dragonstone to lift the siege in order to free up the Red Wine fleet, and it is Lord Waters who informs his Queen Regent of the grave fate of the Knight of Flowers. Cersei surmises that Aurane yearns for the seat of Dragonstone, as his own ascension lacked any land, but she would rather grant him a lesser plot on the mainland of Westeros. Yet, as Cersei continues in her conniving ways, King's Landing grows restless, soon culminating in the arrest of beloved Queen Margaery Tyrell. Aurane promises to deploy the ships that have become his pride into the Blackwater to prevent any attempt to pry Margaery from her cell. But before he can receive confirmation for such an action, the balance of power shifts drastically. Cersei herself is imprisoned by the Faith of the Seven, and with his source of authority toppled to the ground, Aurane flees, From her cell, Cersei hears the news from Qyburn, who explains that Aurane has fled, along with his ships, onto the open seas. And though it is merely hearsay, Aurane Waters may appear in The Winds of Winter. Rumors abound of a pirate lord called Lord of the Waters, having taken up residence in the Stepstones. This unknown brigand commands thunderous, three-decked warships, similar to those constructed by Aurane Waters. So, while it is difficult to know with certainty at the present moment, the Bastard of Driftmark could still have a part to play in the narrative to come. Like many of the Queen Regent's confidants and advisors, Aurane Waters is an unconventional choice to be a member of the Small Council. While it is true he possesses the knowledge and experience required for his position, the Grand Admiral, formerly Master of Ships, his appointment still breaks with common practice. He is a bastard, not a great lord of a coastal kingdom. He is a relative nobody, not a well-known or well-liked highborn. But most of all, he is a choice of benefit to Queen Regent Cersei Lannister, not the most decorated in his field. To Cersei, Aurane Waters is one of many who will owe her his allegiance due to the favor granted him through ascension to the Small Council. Of course, being the Bastard of Driftmark, he possesses wisdom in the realm of shipbuilding and maintenance, but Cersei believes Aurane fancies her, and so seeks to win another dangerous man to her side through manipulation and unprompted favors. And while she remains in power, it works. Aurane rebuilds the royal fleet after the universally destructive Battle of the Blackwater, giving Cersei and her son King Tommen enough naval power to challenge the Ironborn across the continent. Like the others on the Small Council, the Bastard of Driftmark is competent enough to draw too much negative attention, but when Cersei becomes mired in her colossal web of lies and deceit, her pawns topple alongside her. This includes Aurane Waters. He is smarter than some of his contemporaries, however, and flees before he can experience the ramifications of his rise to power. And while blood, oath, and experience create everlasting and loyal bonds between some monarchs and their subjects, the coin and lust offered by Cersei is hardly enough to entice Aurane Waters to stay. Instead of remaining staunch by his benefactor's side through troubled times, he seeks further fortune elsewhere, and he can hardly be blamed for that. When aligning with a backstabber, one can never be certain enough. And so it is with the Bastard of Driftmark. Aurane can clearly see the fall of Cersei will surely mean the demise of his own blossoming political career, and so returns to the seas, the place he has called home many nights before. Aurane Waters rose from a defeated rebel to Grand Admiral of the Iron Throne, but that was no guarantee of indefinite loyalty. He replenished the royal fleet with grand warships to rival even the most impressive ironborn vessels, and basked in the luxury awarded through his friendship with the ruling Queen Regent. But when the tides turned in the capital, Aurane did not stay and fight for she who elevated him. Instead, he retreated to that which he knew, leaving the Queen Regent to face her fate with few friendly faces. He held no qualms about abandoning his post, as his loyalty was merely as deep as his pockets. Aurane Waters, above all else, displayed his fleeting fellowship. So, that's all for this video. Leave a comment with your thoughts, I'd love to hear them. Leave a like if you enjoyed, and subscribe if you're new here, I'd love to have you. Visit my website russellawellsauthor.com for exclusive reviews, fiction, and more. And sign up for my mailing list for free exclusive content. The links for both are in the description below. And, like always, I will see you next time.